I'm Colonel James, Chief Operations Officer for the York County School Division. And I want to thank each and every one of you for joining us tonight for a community forum, an informational session on the medical aspects of adolescent sleep patterns. In the audience tonight, we have two of our board members, Dr. Robert George, Board Chair from District 5, and Mrs. Cindy Kursky, Board Member from District 2. Also, our superintendent, Dr. Victor Shandor. Over the last few years, the school board has had multiple discussions related to emerging trends for later high school start times based on research and data associated with adolescent sleep patterns and the impact of school start times on student health, growth, and achievement. Earlier this year, the school division conducted a survey to determine the level of knowledge our community has on this topic and how we could best provide information to our stakeholders. Most respondents to the survey indicated that online materials, and there are materials posted on our website relative to adolescent sleep patterns, and also an informational session would be beneficial, which is what we're doing tonight. As you may notice, this session is being taped. It will be on our website for those that are not here this evening that would love to hear the same information. We have two guests, as you can see on the stage, with us this evening to provide more information on this topic. Following their presentations, they will entertain any questions that you may have on the topic of adolescent sleep patterns. When that portion, the Q&A portion of this program starts, we would like for all individuals to come to the mic here down front to ask your questions so it too can be recorded for the individuals that are not here this evening. First, I'll introduce Dr. Robert Vorona. Dr. Vorona is a professor at Eastern Virginia Medical School in the Division of Sleep Medicine, where he has been in practice for, 17 years. He has, however, over 30 years' experience in treating patients with sleep disorders. Dr. Vorona is a program director at the EVMS Sleep Medicine Fellowship and medical director, where he devotes 10% of his time to performing research with fellow specialist students and mentees. He has a particular interest in consequences of insufficient sleep in adolescence, and particularly the potential role of early high school start times, including drowsy driving. Dr. Robert Vorona. Darrel Drobnich is president of the Mid-ARM Group, a consulting firm founded in 2003. He has more than 25 years of experience in translating scientific findings into public health messages, educational programs, public policy, and advocacy initiatives in both the United States Senate as Chief Program Officer for the National Sleep Foundation and other nonprofit clients. Please welcome our guests, Dr. Vorona and Mr. Darrel Drobnich. Dr. Vorona. Okay.
Well, first of all, it's my pleasure coming up from Norfolk to talk tonight. And as you can see, the topic, adolescent sleep health, an imperative for health, safety, and well-being. Okay, the first disclaimer, I am indeed a professor at EVMS, and I've been there for quite some time, but I'm speaking for Bob Vorona tonight. I'm not speaking on behalf of the medical school. I always like to start my talks by giving you my goals. So what are my goals? First of all, we'll give you a definition of sleep, and we'll talk about how important sleep is. Sleep is a biological necessity. Then we'll talk about the changes in sleep that occur specifically in our adolescence. We'll talk about high school start times, early high school start times impact, and then we'll transition to talking about the myriad consequences of reduced sleep in our teens. And then finally, we'll end with discussion of improvements that occur with increasing sleep amounts. So what is sleep?
probably one of the best places you can go to get a definition of sleep is the premier textbook in sleep medicine, Principles and Practice of Sleep Medicine. And sleep is defined as, quote, a reversible behavioral state of perceptual disengagement from and unresponsiveness to the environment, end quote. Now, what that means is most of us we're basically not aware of what's going on when we sleep. One of the fascinating things about being a sleep doctor is that it's not infrequent that the patient comes to me and he or she has no earthly idea that they have a problem, but their spouse will say, well, Dr. Vorona, he or she snores. He or she is choking or gasping during their sleep. He or she is excessively sleepy during the day. So we are not in tune with the environment when we're asleep. But it's important to note that sleep is a very active process. It is not a state of inactivity. Just to give you a very short primer on sleep, there are basically four different stages of sleep. And the lightest stage of sleep is stage one sleep. And that's your portal into sleep. That's only about 5 to 7% of the night. And actually, if you wake somebody up in stage one sleep, they'll probably tell you they were awake. So it's very, very light. The biggest chunk of sleep is stage two sleep. That's about 50-55% of the night. It's a more stable sleep. Your heart rate slows. Your breathing is very regular. Deep sleep, or delta sleep, or slow wave sleep, is really the stage of sleep. It's thought to be regenerative. It's also the stage of sleep where it's the hardest to wake folks up from. It has the highest arousal threshold. And teens and youngsters have a lot more deep sleep than do folks, say, of my age. We lose that deep sleep as we age. And last but not least, there's REM sleep. And REM sleep, or rapid eye movement sleep, is dreaming sleep. And it's fascinating from the standpoint that it is just as different in some ways from the other non-REM sleep that I just talked about as sleep is from wake. If you look at the brain waves, they actually look like they're awake, but you have eye movements, and aside from your main breathing muscle, your diaphragm, and your eye muscles, you're paralyzed, and you're supposed to be paralyzed. So those are our stages of sleep. Sleep is a biological necessity. We need it just as much as we need to eat or drink, and it is critical for memory and learning, for proper mood, for performance, for example, driving, for the immune system. There was a large study that showed that nurses who achieved less sleep were more likely to develop pneumonia. There's evidence that if you inoculate somebody with a cold virus, those folks who get less sleep are more likely then to develop a cold. So it's important for the immune system. And there are more and more studies now that show with less sleep come higher rates of obesity, more diabetes, more heart disease, more high blood pressure, all scourges in the American society. And lest you think these are only problems with adults, that's not so. You can look at studies that show that children or adolescents who get less sleep are more apt to be obese. Let's talk about what happens specifically in our teens, in our adolescents. Dr. Gangwich, I think, summarized things very nicely. He said, quote, adolescence is a period of significant physical, cognitive, emotional, and social change, end quote. I mean, really, what else is left? I mean, it's a time of tremendous transition. And Darrel and I were just talking to a member of your audience who was kind enough to show us a book on adolescent brains. And, you know, my comment was, unlike perhaps we wish, adolescent brains are different than adult brains. It's a time of tremendous transition. If you look at adolescent sleep needs also are different than, for example, adults. Last year, Sleep Health, a sleep journal, published work from a task force that was convened by the National Sleep Foundation. Had a number of very erudite folks, and one of them, our own Dr. Ware at EVMS. And what they did was they looked at the literature, and they tried to figure out the correct amount of sleep for the entire lifespan. So, for example, a newborn needs probably between 14 and 17 hours of sleep per 24-hour period. If you look at the teen needs 8 to 10 hours, and most of the data demonstrate that teens probably need around 9 and a quarter hours of sleep to be at their best. That's not the same as an adult. Most of the data suggests that adults require about 7.5 to 8 hours of sleep. So teens require more sleep than do adults. So then the next question is, if teens require 9 hours of sleep, are they getting it? So the answer is no, okay? I think the data are inescapable. Most teens in this country are not getting the recommended amount of sleep. So the Youth Risk Behavior Survey queried over 14,000 students from both public and private high schools. Only 8% of the high school students were getting nine or more hours of sleep on school night. And by the way, by the time you got to 12th grade, only 4% were. And there have been other studies that show that as our teens go from 9th to 12th grade, there's a reduction in the amount of sleep they obtain. 69% of teens in this large study were getting insufficient sleep, less than 8 hours. And insufficient sleep was more common, as I mentioned earlier, in the higher grades, in females, and in African Americans. Closer to home, I grew up in Fairfax County, and so it's interesting, they had a Fairfax County Youth Survey. They looked at 8th, 10th, and 12th graders, almost 28,000 students, large study. And they had a question about, you know, how much sleep do you schools, you 8th, 10th, and 12th graders get on a weekday night? The average was 6.5 hours. So they're getting roughly 2.5 hours less sleep than what is recommended. Only 3% of Fairfax County high school students were getting 9 hours of sleep per night. Now, let me mention a couple of things that I think are important. Number one, this was done at a time when Fairfax County still started high schools at 7:20 in the morning. As Darrel knows far better than I, in the last year, Fairfax County switched to an 8:10 starting time. So this was a time when they were starting schools as they do in York County and, frankly, as they do in my own Virginia Beach. The other thing I wanted to mention, I wanted to bring up this idea of sleep debt. You remember I mentioned that they were getting about 6.5 hours of sleep per night, these teens, about 2.5 hours less sleep than they should per night. What the data show is you don't get used to that insufficient sleep. Rather, what happens, it looks like if you get insufficient sleep night after night, if you get 2.5 hours less sleep night after night, your performance goes down, down, down. So there's a cumulative impact, a sleep debt that you achieve because you get insufficient sleep night after night. Not only do teens have a need for more sleep than adults, not only do they need probably about 9 hours of sleep to be at their best, but there are also significant changes in the timing of when teenagers' brains and bodies want to be asleep and when they want to be awake. The master clock, which is called the suprachiasmatic nucleus, has been shown to shift to a later bed and wake time. That is, teens' brains want to go to bed later and want to wake up later. It's a biological necessity. Now, I will freely admit, beyond that biological necessity, that there are other factors that cause teens to go to bed late. Homework, electronics, social activities, after-school jobs. I mean, I have 3 daughters. The youngest is now 23. But, you know, we went through this high school period in Virginia Beach where everybody had to be up, start school at 7:20. I'm quite aware not only of the need to get up quite early for that time, but also these other factors. Now, what is the impact of early high school start times on teen sleep? Well, the major arbiter, the major factor that determines when a teen has to get up on a school day is school. And in addition to that, it is that same factor that is critical as far as causing teens to get insufficient sleep if the school start time is early enough. There was an interesting study done by Hansen et al. That showed that when teens went from a summer schedule to that first week of school, they lost an average of 2 hours of sleep per night. So with early high school start times, 2 things happen. Number one, because teens' brains and other factors cause them to go to bed late, they're going to bed late, but they're waking up early. And so they're getting less sleep hours. Okay, and one of those, even though they have to go to, even though they have to start school early, they're going to go to bed late for numerous reasons, including biology. But in addition, because of this shift in circadian rhythms where teens' brains want to go to bed late and want to wake up late, probably optimally perhaps 11 p.m. to 8 a.m., you're asking teens, for example, at first bell, to use their brain at a time when their brain wants to still be asleep. So imagine trying to learn mathematics, chemistry, physics, English at a time when your brain is not fully engaged for learning. Doesn't work very well. And so students in early morning classes, they report being less alert. They're more weary, and they have to expend greater effort to succeed. You know, as was mentioned earlier, I have a busy clinical practice. I see patients 4 days a week, and I see plenty of teachers, including teachers from Virginia Beach. And I have yet to have a teacher from Virginia Beach tell me that he or she thinks his or her students are fully engaged in that first bell. Now, why would we show you a jet airliner and talk about a jet-lagged teen? How many people in the audience sleep better when they fly to San Francisco or they fly to, say, England? Nobody should say yes. Nobody sleeps better, okay? Our internal rhythms are out of sorts with the environment, and we don't sleep well, we don't feel as well during the day, our gastrointestinal tract can suffer. Well, on average, teenagers are sleeping about 2 hours more per night on weekends. What they do, they go to bed late, and they sleep in even later. And so what they do, they cause their own jet lag. They actually basically shift, they do a shift in their internal rhythms of about two time zones, and they're doing this every week. And what happens is these teens go to bed late, they wake up really late, and then Sunday comes. And oh no, now I got to be up at, you know, I got to be up at 6 in the morning. My daughter Sarah, I think she was up way back when, 5:45 or so. Now they've got to try and go back to bed earlier and wake up early, and it doesn't work out very well. And there are actually data that show that just that sort of shift can have profound metabolic impact. Our metabolic system does not work as well with those sorts of shifts. So let's talk a little bit more about the negative impact of insufficient sleep in teens. Worsen academics. When you don't get enough sleep, you're more distractible. You have a poor attention span, poor organizational skills, poor motivation. I challenge anybody to tell me how any of that is going to make you a better student. There are changes for the worse in behavior. Teens can be more irritable, easily frustrated. There's increased risk-taking, increased impulsivity, and we're going to talk about a couple of ways that could be really problematic from the standpoint of driving safety or utilizing drugs of abuse or alcohol. There are declines in mood, increases in depression and anxiety, and as we'll talk about shortly, increases in crash rates. So there are myriad consequences for the worse that occur as a secondary to insufficient sleep in our adolescents. So let's burrow down a little bit and talk about academics. Dr. Wilson Karskaden, Dr. Karskaden is probably the maven as far as doing research looking at the changes in sleep that occur in teens. They looked at what the consequences might be of less sleep or later bedtimes on academics. And what they found was those teens who had less sleep or later bedtimes, 25 minutes less sleep, and a bedtime of 40 minutes later, they had more C's, D's, and F's. You might think, well, you know what, I'll catch up. I'll catch up with my sleep on the weekend. What they found was delaying sleep times on the weekends was also associated with worse grades. Another study done more recently showed that if and this was, I think it was in Sweden, but it was over 40,000 students. If you got less than 7 or 8 hours of sleep and you had disturbed sleep, that was associated with failing more than one subject. How about risk-taking and impulsivity? Less sleep, disturbed sleep associated with risk-taking, delinquent behavior. And think about the impact of risk-taking behaviors on our young drivers. young drivers, early drivers are, they're inexperienced, they're poor drivers, and the last thing you need beyond that is impulsivity or the, you know, the idea of risk-taking. Because of some of the research we've done, I've seen the crash rates in the Commonwealth in Virginia Beach and Chesapeake and Chesterfield County, Henrico County, for teens compared to adults. And I'm sorry to say, teens are horrible drivers. You know, it used to be that when I was young, we thought it was just boys who were bad drivers compared to teen girls, but that's not even true anymore. And I can say, you know, having paid for the car insurance of my three daughters, I didn't catch a break. The crash rates are roughly four times greater in teens than adults. How about risk-taking, impulsivity from the standpoint of substance abuse? We have worked down here in Tidewater with folks at GMU looking at the Fairfax County Youth Survey. And what we found was that Dr. Winsler and the rest of us, that less sleep was associated with more smoking, more alcohol abuse, and more illicit drug use. And others have shown similar findings. How about changes in mood? This was a really striking thing from the study we did looking at things in Fairfax County. Quote, just 1 hour less of weekday sleep was associated with significantly greater odds of feeling hopeless, seriously considering suicide and suicide attempts, end quote. And we all know what a scourge suicide is in teens. And a study from 11 European countries, almost 12,000 students, showed that less sleep was associated with, quote, emotional and peer-related problems and suicidal ideation, end quote. So I think that's pretty well established. How about crashes? 16 to 24-year-olds getting more drowsy crashes. They just do. And drowsy crashes, I can tell you, are bad crashes. Recently, it was estimated that 16% of crashes that are fatal were associated with being drowsy. So they're bad crashes. There was a study out of Australia that showed in young adults that getting less 6 hours of sleep per night was associated with more crashes. I mean, it just makes sense. You're not going to be as vigilant, not as attentive. You won't have the same reaction time. It just doesn't work out very well. We've done a couple of studies, and I want to talk about them a little bit because they're so close to home. I hope that y'all in York County would find them of interest. I'll tell you, the reason we did the first study looking at crash rates in Virginia Beach and Chesapeake was pretty personal. My youngest daughter, Sarah, who graduated a couple years ago from William & Mary, she went to public high school in Virginia Beach. She had to be up before 6 o'clock, and because of academics and athletics and whatnot, her cello, most times she was going to bed at midnight after. And I just thought, this is crazy. I'm a sleep doctor, and I can't get my own daughter to go to bed at a reasonable time and get enough sleep. And one day I was at work, and I was seeing a patient who was a Chesapeake school administrator. And it was the first appointment. I like to talk a little bit, get to know folks. And I said, well, what time do y'all start school? I had no idea. He said 8:45. And I was stunned. So what we did, we thought, okay, well, you've got two demographically very similar cities. They're right next to one another, so you can't claim that it's snowing in Virginia Beach and it's balmy in Chesapeake. And they have remarkably different high school start times. Virginia Beach starts at 7:20, Chesapeake starts at 8:45. Why don't we compare crash rates in teens between the two jurisdictions, but we'll look at adults too. And what we found was that it was Virginia Beach with the early high school start time that had a significantly higher crash rate amongst teens than the late starting high school jurisdiction, Chesapeake. That was not replicated in adults. Now, can I prove that was because of the early high school start times? I can't, but it was very provocative. If something had been systemic between Virginia Beach and Chesapeake, you would have thought that it would have been seen in adults too. What we then did, and I would urge you to think about this anytime you hear something on TV or the paper about some great scientific breakthrough, first thing you ought to be thinking about is, has anybody replicated that study yet? So that's what we did. We were lucky enough to work with some folks at VCU, and we looked at Chesterfield County, which starts at 7:20 in the morning, and its neighbor, Henrico County, which starts at 8:45. Again, immediately adjacent, very demographically similar, and we looked at the same thing. We looked at teen crash rates, and we looked at adult crash rates, and we found the same thing, that it was the early starting jurisdiction that had higher teen crash rates, and there was no difference in crashes between the adults. And by the way, if you're thinking, well, maybe there's differences in congestion between Virginia Beach and Chesapeake, or between Chesterfield County and Henrico County, we tried to look at that too, and we could find no differences in congestion. So what we found is in two different sets of Commonwealth school jurisdictions, we found the exact same thing, and in fact, over four straight years. How about athletics? I'll freely say I'm a big sports fan, and it's interesting to talk about the impact of lack of sleep in athletes. For a number of reasons, athletes may get less sleep, whether it's their training, some of the, travel, that sort of thing. And less sleep impairs cognition, mood. It makes you more apt to engage in risk-taking behavior. None of that's good for a high-performing athlete. Less sleep has been associated with lower performance on treadmill and tennis serving. And actually, less sleep has also been associated with an increased risk of orthopedic injuries. How about the benefits of increased sleep? Well, they're numerous. We'll drill down on this in just a little bit, but improved attention on tests, better mood, alertness, motivation, and class attendance. There are some data, but I think Darrel and I will freely admit, not enough, but there are some, on better grades in core subject areas and state and national achievement tests. Lower crash rates, we'll talk about that in a little bit more depth, and better athletic performance, better free throw shooting, better three-point field goal shooting, and better serving in tennis. So people have shown that athletes do better. And I have a friend, actually, a sleep colleague, who is in Charlottesville, Chris Winter. He's a fine sleep doctor, but he's got a niche now. He actually goes to teams like the Oklahoma City Thunder and the San Francisco Giants, and he advises them on sleep and travel schedules and whatnot, because these high-performing teams and athletes know that to be at their best, they've got to get the best quality sleep possible. So let's talk about a few aspects where sleep extension has been shown to be helpful. Here's a study from Israel. They delayed a middle school for a week. It was only 5 days. They delayed for 1 hour the start of school. The first thing they did was they looked very carefully at whether the students got more sleep. Because one of the things people say is, okay, if you delay the school opening, they'll just go to bed later. Well, actually, in this study, they were able to show that the students, when they were able to go to school an hour later, they got 55 minutes more sleep. So they didn't just go to bed later. And the other thing is, they looked at not one, but two different tests of attention, and just those 5 days of increased sleep led to improvements in those students. And by the way, they had what we call a control group. They had another group of students where they did not have them go to school later, and they didn't see that improvement. There was a study done in Rhode Island in a private school that delayed high school start time by 30 minutes. The first thing that was fascinating from the study was actually the students got, on average, about 45 minutes more sleep. So they actually ended up going to bed a little earlier. And there were some comments, apparently, by the students saying that they felt better, so they thought maybe they'd go to bed even a little bit earlier. After the change in delaying the school start time by 30 minutes, there was a 79% reduction in the students who got less than 7 hours of sleep. After that 30-minute delay in start time, 55% of their students got 8 or more hours of sleep versus only 16% before. And with that, with those increases in sleep, came reductions in complaints of fatigue and decreased motivation. There was less decreased motivation. There was less depression. There was less irritability. And interestingly enough, when they looked at after-school activities to include sports, there was no reduction in those sorts of activities. So, what can we do? There are a few basic steps to consider. Changing school hours, you all are thinking about that. You can also increase teenagers' sleep by decreasing the amount of stimulating activities late at night. TV, phone, the internet. You know, I was telling Darrel that I read a very interesting study last night. And one of the things they said is just by virtue of the parents setting a bedtime, in about 70% of cases, teens tried their best to adhere to that bedtime. Now, you can't make an unreasonable, you know, as a father, I couldn't tell my teenager, you need to go to bed at 8 o'clock. That's not going to work, okay? Their brains are not going to do that. But by virtue of setting a set bedtime, the teens were trying to adhere to that in about almost 70% of cases. Increasingly, it's clear that all sorts of electronics are bad news as far as our teens' sleep. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Number one, to the extent that we do all sorts of other things in the bedroom, we're basically teaching ourselves that the bedroom is a place for being awake. And obviously, you know, to the extent your teen is interested in socializing, that's going to delay when they go to sleep. But the other thing is, what is nature's cue that tells us not that it's time to go to sleep, but that it's time to wake up? And that's light. And it doesn't have to be from the sun. It can be from your smartphone. It can be from your laptop. So when a teen, or an adult, for that matter, is shining light into his or her eyes, they are basically telling their brain it's time to wake up. And so you already have an adolescent whose brain wants to go to bed later, and by all that light, you're just pushing it later yet. And I think, you know, one of the things that y'all are doing here that I think is very important is just creating a broader awareness of this issue of insufficient sleep and the impact on teens among parents, teachers, physicians, administrators, coaches, you know, all the key stakeholders. And with that, I'll stop. There's our husky Anya. I'm not sure I could sleep in that position, but it seemed to work pretty well for her. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Sorry, is everybody convinced yet? Well, good evening. I just drove down from 3 hours from Washington, D.C. Give me a little love. Good evening. Thank you. So how many people here, is that too much? Take it down a little bit. How many people here are not convinced that sleep is good for their kids? Anyone? Thank you very much. Have a good night. Drive home safely. So Bob's done a wonderful job of covering the biology. What I'm going to try to cover now is some of the experiences that I've dealt with over the last 20 years working on this issue at the National Sleep Foundation, and most recently in Fairfax County, where we successfully changed the school start times there 2 years ago. So I'm with Minimar Group, and we're a consulting firm now that does health and safety issues. I work with American Sleep Apnea Association and WMATA on fatigue issues. So I still have really been involved in the sleep area for about 20 years. And as a history major from University of Michigan, when we started working on this issue about 20 years ago, I had to really wonder, how did we even get here? With early school start times, because everybody was telling me, well, when we were kids, we all went to school together. You know, the high school kids left with elementary school kids. They would walk them to school, and then they would go on to school. So how did this change? Well, looking at the factors, the current start times have nothing to do with biology or science or what's good for our kids. It's based on historical, political, financial, and budgetary issues, not even good planning. So if you even look back to the 1800s when I was a kid, you can see me right here, I'm in the back there. There's always been some type of transportation as we were an agrarian society. Certainly we know that in Virginia and Maryland on farms. And we used to wake up and school was not a necessary factor. Back in the early 1800s, school public education was not even compulsory until later. But you can see as early as 1915, the first school bus was made in South Dakota. So we always had a propensity of trying to bring kids in from the rural farms into the local, one-room schoolhouse. And then around 1919, school districts started to formalize. And you can see here in Ohio, here's a small schoolhouse, went to 1917, and then right in 1917, they got a nice big, almost double in size. So what you had is the urban centers growing out, bringing in the rural areas to form larger and larger school districts, which meant that we're going to have to move more and more kids. And then after World War II, you had the baby boom. You had all these GIs coming back and starting families. You had highways being built. You had suburbanization of rural counties. You had integration with Brown versus Board of Education, where you used to have black schools and white schools. Now you're into the same schools. So you had all these social factors going on. And the way that what that was happening was population growth, the increase of school districts, that meant what? That you're moving more and more school kids into what were then cramped schools. And if you look, most of the schools that exist today were built during the 50s and the 60s. My kids actually went to one in Washington, D.C. that was over 100 years old. And then with the highway, suburbanization, you had this tremendous amount of growth. So in the early 60s, as we saw a rapid increase in the school population, you saw consolidation of the remaining county schools. So the outlying rural areas were brought into the local urban school districts. That meant larger and more complicated school districts. And then in the 1960s, because of this growth, educators started looking for ways to reduce costs. So they started looking at tiered bus systems. So where we'd all be bused on the same bus, you had high school kids going with elementary school kids, you started looking at how can we move more kids using the same number of buses. And then, with 1970, we had court-ordered busing, so that actually meant more people, more pressure on the system. And then in the 70s, we had what was called the recession, where it was a do more with less mentality. And some of you may remember this, but we had huge oil boycotts at that time, which meant what? Higher fuel costs for our buses, right? So that also drove this mentality of try to do more with less resources. So as we came through the 70s, you saw more and more school districts looking at this third tier system. And in fact, when I was talking to Mr. James and some of the board members, they told me that they had one or two tiered system until the 90s. So you guys are actually a little bit later in dealing with this pressure. So now you have what is three tiers, right? But what we found in Fairfax, where they said that they had four tiers, they actually had five. Once we started looking at the system, we found what was called a false tier. And that was where the school bus bell was 7:20. They were literally picking up kids at 5:30 in the morning and then dropping them off at 6:45, where they would sit outside the hallways for a half hour until the teachers came, because that allowed them to have more runs with less school buses and less school drivers. So what's the impact of all this? Well, we know now that the current start times are not based on science or what's best for our kids. It's based on financial concerns and transportation concerns and all these things that we have to deal with. These are all very important issues, but really what we're doing is really balancing the budgets of our school systems on the backs of our kids. And I personally think that that's unfair. So now you have over 19,000 public high schools in the U.S. with a 60% with a start time of 8 a.m. or later. Almost 70% of high school students don't get enough sleep, as Bob mentioned. So my basic premise to surmise here tonight to you is, it was us adults who made this problem, not our children. So it takes adults to create the solutions for these problems. As Bob very adequately went over, these are some of the health effects. And I really want to stress that at the bottom line of this issue, this is a public health issue and a public safety issue, with academic benefits or detriments, depending on which side of the road you're on, okay? But what we're doing with our kids is not only turn them into insomniacs today, but insomniacs later on. Someone who's chubby today might be dealing with obesity or diabetes later on in life.
A lot of grief to contend with tonight in the East Bay after two Bay Area teenage girls were killed in an early morning car crash. Tonight, police say the 16-year-old girl that was driving this car, now smashed to pieces, may have fallen asleep at the wheel. The crash happened overnight about 3 o'clock in the morning. It was on Franklin Canyon Road. This is near McCary Ranch Road, just outside of Martinez. Now, tonight, we are hearing from those who knew the victims. NBC Bay Area's Christy Smith joins us live outside of College Park High School, where the three girls went to school. Christy, this is a very tough story.
Well, absolutely. This has really shaken the community. We've seen parents and students in tears. In fact, the school where the students attended has sent out notice to families letting them know that grief counselors will be here tomorrow.
I know some of you went to school with them. I talked to some of you, and it's very hard for you to understand.
At Christ the King Church tonight, a mass drew teens, many who knew the two teenage girls killed in the car crash.
Just her not being here anymore. I was with her all the time.
Natalie Culver says she was a cousin to one of the girls.
She would always remind me that she loved me, and it's really sad that she's not going to be here anymore.
The coroner has not released their names yet, but the CHP says they were passengers around 3 a.m. with a teenage driver who lost control on Franklin Canyon Road near Martinez and hit a tree, all believed to be 16 or 17.
Preliminarily, we've talked to her, and she said that she fell asleep, and the last thing she remembers was being at 60 miles per hour.
It's a windy road. Investigators say alcohol or drugs don't seem to be a factor. All of the teens believed to be juniors at College Park High School in Pleasant Hill, where a notice went out tonight to families.
It was just really sad.
Adele Gigalis left flowers at the crash site. She says her 16-year-old daughter is heartbroken that she first became friends with one of the girls in elementary school.
It just devastated because we knew the family. We knew her since little. It was very tragic.
Now, we also heard from the superintendent of the school district who expressed condolences to the family, said that thoughts and prayers went out to the families involved in this tragic accident.
So when I started with the National Sleep Foundation, I started with the drowsy driving program, and I've literally worked with hundreds of families, parents, people who have actually killed their spouses when falling asleep at the wheel, truck drivers having fallen asleep at the wheel. If there's nothing else that you take away from tonight, I plead with you, talk to your children about, and all your family members actually, about the dangers of drowsy driving. It's just as important as drunk driving, especially around proms. These kids, good kids, straight A students, were out at 3 o'clock in the morning. And it can just happen just like that. It's happened way, way too much. So what can we do all about this? Well, there's many solutions. Change the school start times is just one. These are some of the perceived barriers that I've heard over the years, and actually talking to some teachers who have said, and I'm still kind of puzzled by this one, and say, well, I actually like the school start times as they are because I get out earlier and I can be on the golf course before everyone else gets off of work. Well, my challenge is to anybody that says that is, how does that help our kids' health and safety at the bottom line? So we know that transportation can be an issue. Budgets are always an issue. Budgets are always an issue for any agency, especially during down times. So that's always, you're always pushed to do more with less. Community use of athletic schools, facilities, reduce after-school employment. These are all issues that we heard in Fairfax. And what I'm here to tell you tonight is, after 20 years of trying to do it in Fairfax, which is the 10th largest school district in the nation, we achieved it. And 2 years later, people couldn't be happier with it. They literally tell me, we don't remember how it was. They're so happy with it, and it's actually showing real benefits within that county. So if they did it, I think anybody can do it. Some of the benefits of changing school start times provides an opportunity for more sleep. But and the science actually shows that kids do take advantage of that. But it has to be followed with education and a real commitment of parents and families and educators about making that a priority, just like with exercise and diet. Improves health both short and long term, improves safety and drowsy driving, improves learning and memory, test scores. All these things that Bob mentioned, improves mood and lowers anxiety, depression, attendance, tardiness, involvement in extracurriculars, activities actually remains the same or actually goes up because people feel more refreshed and more energetic. Other countermeasures, obviously just pushing sleep as a health priority, just like exercise or diet. Include sleep as part of a student health education, biology classes. There's many science experiments that you can do around it. Help students manage their schedule so they have time to make for adequate sleep. Don't let them burn the candle at both ends or overextend themselves. Decrease nightly homework hours. Buffer early start times by setting limits on evening activities. Work with employers to decrease adolescents' work hours. Usually they're pretty open to that. And include drowsy driving in any driver education, which most drivers' education is done by private firms anymore. Do you guys offer driver's ed as part of the schools? Okay, so that's something that you could obviously do there. I'd be more than willing to help you there as well, to give you some curriculum. Give standardized testing after 10 a.m. when adolescents are more alert. Give plenty of notice for large assignments. Educate schools, physicians, mental health providers on the impact of sleep deprivation. Work with your school nurses and your counselors. Educate parents that weekend catch-up is normal. However, sleeping beyond 2 hours past normal wake time is not recommended. These are all the people, but big names that actually have supported changing school start times, everything from the American Academy of Pediatrics to the CDC and Department of Health and Human Services to the Department of Education. So some key take-home points for you. Change is hard, and I've certainly heard that. People get anxious when they say, well, how about my child care? How about my work schedule? How am I going to deal with this? Well, what we do is we kind of have this fear of the unknown. But if you take and deal with the myths and say, no, that's not true, but okay, what are your real issues? If you do an engagement, you hear people out, and you come up with solutions, it can be done. In fact, what we found is, you know, with athletics, impact on school employment, none of these things are really impacted once we worked them out in Fairfax. And we did with over 64 different stakeholder groups. And many of them had concerns that were all satisfied at the end of the day. And with that, I thank you very much.
Thank you, Darrel, and thank you, Dr. Vorona. If you have any questions for Dr. Vorona or for Mr. Drobnich, please come to the mic. Thank you.
Don't be shy.
Simon Williams, I'd like to ask you how they did it in Fairfax. Do you put in extra school buses, or did you just delay everything?
No, so we actually moved the, at the end of the day, I think it cost them, they were going to buy 20 new school buses. But I have to tell you, the previous transportation consultant that was hired by the superintendent had estimated a $44 million change. And us, who are non-transportation experts, came up with 20 different scenarios, and the highest scenario that we had was something around $21 million. The one that they ended up picking was $4.5 million, which out of a $2.3 billion budget is small pittance. And what it actually did was change a whole hour for high school students and move the middle schools. And there was a commitment. We wanted to get the middle schools actually later as well, too. But what I can tell you is what it really took was an outside group dealing with all the different stakeholders, because what we had seen after 20 years of kind of muddling around with the issue, there was a lot of distrust on both sides. And actually, our first meeting with the director of transportation, you got the sense that saying she wasn't going to play ball, and she actually said, yeah, you guys are the fifth group I've dealt with. It's not going to happen. She ended up taking early retirement, and we made it happen. So it took getting rid of all the mythology and really dealing with the issues of concern and then bringing everybody to the table to sort it out in an open and fair manner. I think that's what it really took, was the engagement. You could talk about science all day long, but it wasn't really the science. If you don't want to believe the science, you're not going to believe the science. If you want to believe it, you're going to believe it. What it took was addressing people's concerns about how it was going to impact their life to make it happen. I want to hear a question from a student. Nothing? There you go.
How long did it take you to incorporate the later start times in the school?
In Fairfax?
Yeah.
So we were hired actually for a 6-month contract, and we actually pushed back on the board a little bit, saying that for a school district that large, we wanted to actually have a lot of engagement and then come up with the scenarios, have the school board vote on it, and then give it almost a full year for the community and all the different departments to come in line to do proper planning. Once we met with all the different departments, they really said, with a school system this large, it was going to take a lot of work to, once we got the green light, to actually change the curriculum and change some policies. So that allowed the teachers and the parents and the activities and athletic groups to all kind of come in line. So we think that, you know, as long as you've, once you push it, you should at least wait another school year to actually implement it. That way people can kind of adjust, get childcare and so forth. Good evening.
How, and we are much smaller school district than Fairfax County. How long would it take for us to implement a more traditional school time of, say, 7:50 a.m. or later for all students in your county? Could you answer that, Edie?
It's a good question. I don't know if I'm equipped to answer that right now, not knowing and met with the school system, looked at different scenarios and so forth. I can tell you Montgomery County, where I live, they changed 20 minutes within a couple months. They actually made it before the previous school year, a couple months beforehand. And it really didn't take that much. Now with Fairfax, you're talking about a full hour. So there was a little bit more logistical things that you had to change around. But I think it's fair to say once you make, if you decide to go with a change, if you have 5 to 6 months to prepare, I think mm-hmm. that would be adequate.
And I don't know if you're aware of this, you may or may not be. You have spoken with many of our board members and people in transportation, but we actually do have a false tier built into our program as well, because some of the students are arriving at high school as early as 6:45 and 6:50 in the morning, and school does not start until 7:20.
Yeah, so that's definitely an issue, because you have to really wonder how early, and what I've understood is a lot of those kids live north of the county, right? So they're actually probably waking up at 5:30, somewhere around that area, maybe 5 even.
It doesn't even matter where you live. If you have a daughter and she has to flat iron her hair in the morning, God forbid she doesn't apply makeup, it could be a 5 o'clock start just for that preparation in and of itself.
Yeah.
The other thing I wanted to bring to your attention as well is our former superintendent had looked at school start times. And I think personally, it's feasible for us to still have a 3-tier bus system. If we were to have elementary school could even start at, say, 7:50 if they don't want to start high school that early, for whatever reason, because of sports, et cetera.
Right.
By the way, Grafton High School is the only high school that does not have any lights on their football field. So we are the only ones who would be hurt in terms of early practice in the morning like they do at college.
Right.
Because at college, all the sports practices take place before school, and then games are after school.
Right.
So kids would still be more awake, those that wanted to participate in sports, and they could also be home to take care of their siblings after school if elementary did start earlier than high school, and middle school being the last to go. And the bottom line, a study out in Minnesota said they changed their school bus system as well. The bus is driving the same routes at different times. Nothing's changed.
Yeah.
Just who goes to school first, second, and third.
Yeah.
And that's how I feel it is in your county, as far as comparing apples to apples.
Yeah, and what we found in Fairfax was when you take the same people and have them look at the same solutions.
Right.
They don't find anything different. So when we came in, we were told by the transportation experts, we're running as efficiently as possible. Well, two doctors and a knucklehead from Detroit looked at it and said, well, did you try this? And what we found out is each scenario, out of 20 that we ran, we found more and more efficiencies. So we ended up saving a lot of money by just asking stupid questions, saying, why can't you do it that way? And it was, well, we've always done it that way. Well, why do you do it that way? I don't really know. It's just going to kind of hand it down. So kind of looking at an old problem with fresh eyes often brings new solutions. So I strongly believe in that. Mm-hmm. And what we did was bring all the people to the table as a stakeholder. Not to say, do you think we should do this? We said, how can we do this? So if you're going to present a problem, you also have to present a solution, a possible solution to that.
Correct.
Too. So once you change the mindset and saying the leadership wants this, it's going to happen. Help us make it happen and lessen the impact on you.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody seemed to kind of come around that, and it was very positive. And people that were kind of somewhat suspicious or opposed ended up supporting the proposals in the end.
And I want to thank both of you for coming out and helping us educate the citizens of your county so that they're aware of this. There are a lot of people who are receiving mixed messages, not necessarily all the correct information at times. So by doing this, this will hopefully help people decide whether or not they're for a more traditional school start time of, say, 7:50, 8 o'clock or later for all students within the county, versus keeping the current schedule that we have in place now, where students arrive at least a half hour early to school. Thank you for your time, and be safe traveling home.
Well, thanks. And I also want to thank Dr. Shandor and the school board and the community for taking this step, because I think it is a public health issue. And just the fact that you're getting information out there and having these discussions is very, very important.
Okay, hi. I just wanted to make a comment. My name's Christine Leakey, and my family just moved here from Texas. And we had three older children who went through the Texas school system, and now I have an elementary school kid. So this is actually a really important issue for me, because in Texas of all places, went ahead with the evidence, and they started their teenagers late. And I had three teenagers go through high school there.
Which part of Texas?
In Killeen, Texas. And they started at 8:45. They also went through middle school there, so they started at 8:05, and then my little one started in elementary school there. They were at 7:30, and the teenagers did really, really well with that, and so I think that I had less cranky teenagers growing up. They all did after-school activities, and you know Texas with their football and Friday Night Lights, there was no impact on the football teams at all, and my kids also worked after school jobs. Again, no impact with that. So this issue is important to me because I have one more kid coming through, and I'm like, okay, in 3 years, 3 years, we got to get that 8:45, high school start time. So I'm glad that this was an issue that was brought up, and I really hope that the switch is made. But again, being in different school systems and seeing how it worked, I think that this would be a real improvement for our teenagers.
One of the things I have mentioned to folks who have concerns in Virginia Beach about making the change, for example, from the standpoint of athletics, and as much as I love athletics, I don't think that should be the driving force of our public school systems. But Chesapeake seems to do just fine. They start at 8:45 and they win plenty of state football championships and baseball championships and whatnot. The other thing I wanted to mention, and this is my fault for not bringing it up, I forgot. There are actually studies that show that when you delay high school start times, that this issue of teen crashes is improved. So one of my favorite people in sleep medicine is Barbara Phillips at the University of Kentucky. And she and a gentleman, Dr. Danner, out of UK, they looked for 2 years at teen crash rates after Fayette County, which is where Lexington is, delayed high school start times by an hour. And what they found over the next 2 years, there was a 16.5% reduction in teen crashes. You might say, well, that's probably what happened the rest of the Commonwealth of Kentucky. Actually not. The rest of the Commonwealth, which did not change high school start times, over those same 2 years had an 8% increase in teen crash rates. So there actually are some data out there that when you make that sort of change, that there are safety benefits for teens.
And as a father of a 15 and 14-year-old, if there's any secrets you can tell about getting a less cranky teenager, please share them.
Who is turning 13 on Sunday, so beware with me. I was just wondering if you gentlemen have some suggestions on parents of how we can get more support or how we can lend support to the school board, because it sounds like you're an independent group who came in. Who paid for you? How did we get you in? Did the school board have to hire you? Do the parents come forth and say, please, we need your assistance?
So our contract was initiated, I believe, by the school board, and so we are consultants to the York County School Division to do education. So you'll see some of the fact sheets, and we'll be doing more fact sheets. We really want to hear from you all to hear what concerns were, so we can tailor some of those. And then we'll be providing a report on the biology, but also some steps that you can do to go forward.
Perfect.
Going on.
Because we've tried to communicate through like Facebook websites, you know, for early start times to get some parental support as well. Is there anything else that we can do to try to show the school board that this is something we want to implement as soon as possible?
Well, I certainly think expressing that to the school board, to Dr. Shandor, but I also think, I know that some of you are out there working with the communities with a petition and so forth.
Okay.
And I think just educating your neighbors and friends and family about the issue. Usually you'll hear it's more about the inconvenience or the scare of how it's going to impact their schedule. But I've never heard in 20 years anyone saying, well, changing school start times later is going to be harmful to our kids.
Right.
People will say, well, you're not preparing them for the workforce if they're not waking up at 5:30 in the morning. Well, I can tell you, I've been in the workforce, and if I have to wake up at 5:30 in the morning, I wouldn't be doing too well either.
Yes.
So.
Well, thank you. Thank you both for this, because it is a health concern. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Vivian Moore, a parent of a tween and a teen, and I thank you gentlemen both for being here today.
Your combat pay.
Okay, two questions. One, Dr. Vorona, you kind of mentioned the biology of a teen as to what happens when they are sleep deprived. When I share my concern with a lot of parents, I often hear they just need to go to bed earlier. What's the problem? And you kind of talked about it, but I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more exactly how different, because I do think a lot of parents confuse our teenagers for adults.
Right. And you know, that's a great point. Teens' brains are not adult brains. And there is this clear shift in sleep and wake patterns. And so, their brains want to go to bed later, and they want to wake up later. And so if you want to start schools at 7:20 in the morning or whatnot, you can do that, but that's not going to be in synchrony with when a teen wants to be awake and he or she will be at his or her best. But I'll also say this, as the father of three daughters, you know, thankfully, I guess, the youngest now being 23, so I'm beyond the teen phase. Next time I'll see that, hopefully, as a granddad. You know, there are things that we as parents can do, too. And that's why I talked a little bit about having parental set bedtimes. You know, one of the things that was interesting in the paper I was referring to about parental, when parents said, you know, you have to go to bed at X time, one of the things that teens got out of that was, you know what, I think mom and dad care a little bit more about me, okay, because they're setting the rules here. So I think that's important. I think just being aware also of the pernicious impact of all these electronics. You know, I'm 60 years old. I had a little transistor radio that I could listen to the Washington senators under my covers. You know, the senators don't exist and little transistor radios don't exist. But I mean, they have this plethora of electronics, and there's just more and more data that shows that the more electronics that our kids have, the less they in the bedroom, the less they sleep, and the poorer their sleep. And as parents, we have to take charge of that, and we have to get that out of there. And, you know, they may not like it. They may not cotton to that, but that's, you know, that's just too bad. I mean, electronics, they don't need to have a TV, an iPad, their smartphone, the whole nine yards in their bedroom. So there are things also we as parents can do to help our teens get a better shot at sleeping well, and both on weekdays and weekends. I think the other thing is, within reason, you don't want your child having too dramatic a difference in his or her sleep time on the weekend compared to the weekday. And we talked about that a little bit with this jet lag and how that can have a pernicious effect on our teens too.
Absolutely. And I do, and I'm a big advocate of setting sleep times, but too often I encounter my teens staring at the ceiling because it's too early. And that's the biology.
That is the biology. You're exactly right. I mean, I probably went through it too quickly, but I mean, I think a lot of us think that probably the average teen's brain wants to go to bed around 11 and wake up around 8. I mean, obviously there's a bell curve. Everybody's not the same, but I think that's about right. So if you tell your teen, and I mentioned this, if you tell him or her, you need to go to bed at 8:30 every night, that's not going to happen. You're right. They'll just sit there in their bedroom staring at the wall, or if they have their electronics, they'll be staring at that. So it has to be reasonable, and I think that's why we're talking about high school start times and delaying them, because I think that'll make educating our teens easier. I think it'll make parents' jobs easier, getting them to bed at the right time and waking up at the right time. I think it'll be a nice thing for their safety, too.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Drobnich, you mentioned in one of your PowerPoint slides that 60% of student or schools in the U.S. start school times 8 a.m. or later. Mm-hmm. And I was curious if you could elaborate on that. Is that specifically high schools or all schools in our nation?
And I believe that was all schools, because that would be too high for high schools. Yeah, high schools are on the other side. Most of them start before 8 o'clock.
That was it. Thank you very much. And I thank you both, as do many of us, that you're here. I've learned a lot.
Welcome.
Thank you.
And just to emphasize Bob's point, too, so with that shift is very real. So it's like taking somebody who just came in from Los Angeles into New York and said, okay, go to bed at 11 o'clock New York time. Well, they're still at 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock on their time. It just is not going to happen. That's literally what happens during that adolescent phase. And it can actually persist into early college, into your early 20s.
You know, one of the things that people, how many people here take melatonin to help themselves sleep? You know, melatonin is a so-called dark hormone. It comes from a tiny part of the brain called the pineal gland. And it's the hormone that helps us fall asleep. Well, folks like Dr. Karskadden have looked at melatonin rhythms, and they've shown that when you reach puberty, when you get to that time, that melatonin time of, you know, rise, it's delayed. Okay, so that gives you a biological answer to this question about, you know, why are they going to bed later and waking up later? It is biology. There's this, you know, incredibly important hormone for our sleep. It shifts later.
Hi, I just have a question. Curious, is there a minimum additional number of minutes that you see a direct positive effect from this? In other words, if you went from 720 to 750, that's 30 minutes. To me, I'm not so sure if you're going to do this thing, does 30 minutes really get these results, or is there a magic time that where you really start to see some much more positive?
I think it's a great question. I think that a couple things. I think the American Academy of Pediatrics really was angling for maybe 8:30 or later optimally for starting high schools. I'm not sure that anybody really knows what the sweet spot is for that amount of time. I suspect that it depends what you look at. So, for example, Dr. Judy Owens, who Darrel worked with up in Fairfax County, you know, when they delayed high school start times, they found all sorts of improvements in mood and, you know, less visits to the school nurse and so forth. But it may be that 30 minutes is not good enough for crashes. Maybe you need an hour delay and more sleep for reducing crashes. So I suspect that it depends what you look at. So I'm not sure, but I think that, and I'll, you know, obviously we'll not speak for Darrel, but my bias based on what I know is if I was going to give this the most serious consideration, I would probably be thinking in terms of trying to start school at for high schoolers at 8:30 and in that area.
Bob's correct. It depends on what you look at. We know that even 20 minutes or 30 minutes improves alertness and mood scores. You got to think, just like sleep is nutrition. So just because I have a better diet, but I still eat a lot of fat, I still might have a bad malnutrition, okay? So I can improve sleep. So any amount of sleep that you get is better than getting less, right? However, if you look at, say, 7:20 compared to 8, you might still be setting yourself up for obesity or diabetes later on in life through that sleep debt. Because if you're not getting the sleep that you need, biologically need, you still have that impairment. So you might improve your alertness, you might improve your mood now, but actually not take away the long-term health effects, whether it's cardiovascular disease, stroke, Alzheimer's. Now they're finding Alzheimer's and dementia associated with long-time short sleep.
And remember, we're talking about not only duration of sleep, but trying to synchronize the teen's optimal capabilities with when they're going to school. So yeah. Trying to be in synchrony with their rhythms too.
Yeah, it's very analogous to malnutrition. So if I have a poor diet for the first 20 years of my life, then all of a sudden I get healthy, I start eating better. I might lose some weight, I might feel better, I might feel more energetic, but what I've done to my connective tissue, my bones, is going to show up later in life. And in fact, we saw that amongst we have an all-star shortstop for the Detroit Tigers who grew up in Cuba with a very poor diet, and he has very bad shins. He had 2 fractures in his shins and missed a whole year because of what he had done, but he's healthy in every other aspect.
I'd like to point out that school start times, it's good to shift it later, but we also have to remember when the kids get picked up by the school bus. My child, who lives 10 minutes from school, has to be at the bus stop at 6:30 in the morning. So even if you have a 7:50 start time, that means he's going to have to be at the bus stop at 7 o'clock. And his brain doesn't even wake up until 8 o'clock. So you still have the deficit.
Hi. I have 2 teenagers. My oldest is actually a senior this year. And I found he had enough credits that he didn't have to have a 1A course. So he does get kind of that built-in later start time. He does 3 sports a year, AP classes, a lot of homework, late nights, and we are seeing a marked difference with attitude of getting that sleep extra time built in because he doesn't have to be up for that 7:10, you know, that earlier start time. Also with what you commented about with the classes, the core classes starting first, and he's, you know, admitted that he's not awake then. Like, it's harder for his brain to be acclimating to what's going on in the classroom. So obviously I'm a proponent for changing the start times. We're military, so we've been in a variety of schools through their career, and this is probably the earliest start time they've had. So I think what you're doing is great, and hopefully they'll move forward with it.
Thank you. And that's another out-of-the-box solution by allowing that flexibility in the morning with if you have enough credits and doing well.
To thank the school board for taking the initiative to listen to the concerns that have been expressed by many parents. I'm a grandparent, but I just wanted to express my appreciation to the school board for arranging for you all to come and make this presentation, which I thought was superb.
Thank you.
You have really generated some significant points, and I appreciate you coming down to share it with us. And I'm not 100% on this, but I believe I read that the Chesapeake County School Division has just developed a plan where they're going to implement the late start times. I think I'm right. Chesapeake County, is that near Chesterfield? Chesterfield, the one that's near Richmond.
They've been so fascinating what Darrel was saying, because when I was working with my colleagues to do this research looking at Henrico County and Chesterfield County, one of the folks I spoke to was the head of public transportation. And he said, Bob, I'm sold. You know, absolutely we should make this change for the students, but you got to figure out how you're going to do this dollars and cents wise with the transportation. So I think they're very interested.
There was an article in the paper. I think they're going to implement it in 2018. So I think the plan is in place. And so anyway, thank you very much.
I think you definitely should thank your school board and Dr. Shandor and the administration for taking this on, because I think it's a very important issue. Obviously, I'm biased, but having this type of forum and doing this type of education, I think, is very important.
Hi, my name is Allison. I'm a nurse with eyewitnessfitness.com, and we do a lot of work with endurance athletes. Okay. And this is really a big concern with their what we call their nerve energy and getting enough sleep with the sleep debt. But I'm also a parent of a 12 and a 10-year-old, and so I was trying to figure out how to use the research of getting more exercise before you take tests and how that increased test scores. So I was curious in Fairfax how that works as far as what the other lady had said, that having practice before school start, if that's what you guys did. And and another thing too is exactly what times do you recommend that you did for Fairfax, and what does that look like?
What times for exercise or?
Well, the actual start times. I haven't heard what you guys actually.
Yeah, it's been a while now. So I believe that they moved to an 8:20 bell for all their high schools, and they had a 7:30 bell for their middle schools, and they were looking to move that. They were looking to bring the middle schools up in parity with the high schools, and I was very, very surprised. We had made that as a recommendation. And very surprised that the school board and the administration took that on as a challenge to make sure that they're continuing, that was just a first step. Athletics, especially in Fairfax County, was a real issue because historically they do not provide athletic programs to the middle and high school schools. Those were actually provided by a intramural sports association, which makes a lot of money off of that, and they actually paid for a lot of the school fields, and they were probably one of the biggest opponents of that because they were very afraid it was going to cut down on the field usage of their adult sports teams as well too. So they were a real group to really contend with. But once we sat down with them and said, you know, what would it help to make it more efficient and more palatable for you, and lighting on some of the fields, allowing to use their gymnasiums like a half hour later. They said, if we can get that, we think we can make it work. So we worked with the department, the operations manager, and we worked it out. And they ended up supporting the recommendation. But I think it's very important to note in athletics, as Bob mentions, is sleep is actually when the growth hormone is secreted. So for young people 11 and 12, it's very important. But it's also when we repair connective tissue and muscle damage from exercise. So that's why you've seen these high-paid athletes on the professional level saying, yeah, I'm paid to do my best on the field, so I sleep. And that's why they're actually working with them. So,
And actually, it's very important. If you have an interest, my friend and colleague, Dr. Winter, will be giving grand rounds, I think it's May 24th, on his work with sleep and professional athletes. He'll be at EVMS.
The other part of that, too, is obstructive sleep apnea, which about half of all linemen within the NFL have, and your risk of death and cardiovascular disease and stroke is very high. And with the obesity epidemic, we've seen a rise in sleep apnea amongst younger children. So those kids that are pressured to get bigger during middle school and high school to be on the football team, they're at very much risk. And there's actually been studies in the NFL with the message of saying, don't use steroids, don't use illegal drugs, obviously, but also don't try to build up too much beyond what your body can actually handle, because you're setting yourself up for sleep apnea.
Mm-hmm.
Twilight too, yeah.
And then, you know, they've also, I remember reading a study that looked at blue blocker glasses, and that may also be a way to mitigate some of the effect, particularly of blue light from these devices that tends to wake us up and delay our start time. But I would take a more simple-minded approach than that. I just think the electronics need to be out of their bedrooms.
Good sleep hygiene. Using it, there's now night shift feature on the iPhone. The American Sleep Apnea Association put out a free app too called Sleep Health that you can actually use to track your sleep and your daytime performance as well too. I'd recommend that because I helped develop it.
Sorry, this is a question. I just want to make sure I understood you correctly earlier. You said that if the students are sleep deprived during the week, say they're getting the 6.5 hours a night, Monday through Friday, to sleep in more than 2 hours later on the weekends to make up for the sleep loss during the week, it would actually be a detriment to their body, and that's how they get jet lagged, if you will, correct?
It really is a conundrum, because they accumulate, let's just take 2 hours. Mm-hmm. So they got a 10-hour sleep debt that they accumulate over the week. And how are you going to make that up in just two nights in the weekend? It's very tough. So you have this conundrum. Well, they got to sleep in because they got to get more sleep because they got to catch up. But on the other hand, by radically shifting their rhythms, they're causing this jet lag, and they're setting themselves up for more problems when the next week comes. It's a tough issue.
And it is a debate even in the sleep world. I'm actually a proponent of saying let them sleep, because I think the more sleep that they get, the better. But don't let them stay up any later than they would normally stay up on the weekend. So don't let them stay up till 2 or 3 to where they're, as Bob's saying, really shifting that clock. You know, if they go to bed at 11 or 12 during the week or the weekday, try to keep it at that, but let them sleep.
Right.
And if they want to take a nap in the afternoon, you know, with my kids, I say, you know, let them sleep even if they need to mow the grass. Just let them sleep and get that as much recuperative sleep as possible.
That was going to be my next question. Would it be best, say, for example, your child gets up at 5 o'clock during Monday through Friday. Saturday, they could get up at, say, like 8 o'clock or 7 o'clock, and then later on in the afternoon, take a nap.
Yeah.
That
would be a very reasonable thing. There's something else I want to bring up about sleep debt that I think is really critical. And that is when people, and it's not just kids, it's adults. If you get insufficient sleep, if you get a block, you know, maybe 2 hours or 3 hours less sleep night after night, your performance goes down, down, down. But what's interesting is if you look at the same folks and you ask them, well, how sleepy are you? They grossly underestimate how sleepy they are. Their ability to assess how sleepy and impaired they are is blunted. So that their performance goes down, 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 but they don't recognize it. And that's why I think a lot of people say, I've gotten used to 5 hours of sleep or 6 hours of sleep. They haven't, but their ability to assess their alertness or lack thereof is impaired.
And those are the first people that are sleeping in a conference or, you know, mm-hmm. Around a table. The beautiful thing about this is the solution is free.
Exactly.
The brain regulates when you're thirsty. When you're thirsty, you're going to drink water. Why are you drinking water in the middle of the afternoon? Well, because I'm thirsty. You fall asleep during the middle of the afternoon, it's because you're tired. You know, it doesn't cost you a thing. There's a lot of sleep commercials and, you know, beds out there saying we're going to be the best sleep. The thing is, if you're sleep deprived, you can sleep on a rock, and it doesn't cost you a thing.
And another thing, too, I think there's a misunderstanding or a myth, if you will, that every child who sleeps in class is a poor student who's been up all night texting their friends, watching social media on their computer, etc. When in essence, the truth of the matter, and I know some friends of mine who are substitute teachers here within York County, they have witnessed firsthand students who are straight A students sleeping in their first black class. She goes over to them and said, "What's up?"
Yeah.
They said they're exhausted because they were up until 1:30, 2 o'clock, finishing up their homework, and
We've actually done a challenge when I was at the National Sleep Foundation of taking people into a high school classroom and said, pick out the kid that has narcolepsy.
Mm-hmm.
And half the kids had their head on the desk.
Yeah. But actually, Darrel brings up a very important point, and that is, and maybe this is the sleep doctor in me, but we should not forget that if the child does have adequate opportunity for sleep, and if he or she is still sleepy, then we need to think about narcolepsy, we need to think about sleep apnea, those things. So, you know, occasionally there are intrinsic sleep disorders that can also afflict our children just like they can afflict adults.
I've done a lot of research on this, and when you said Alzheimer's and dementia being part of a long-term sleep debt, that frightened me.
That's new research that's coming out in the last year or so, and yeah, it's very compelling. But yeah, they're definitely making those links. I mean, you're thinking, so like with sleep apnea, where you stop breathing up to 200, 300 times a night, up to maybe a full minute, mm-hmm. you're depriving your body of oxygen. Okay, so what happens when you deprive your body of that oxygen? Okay, well, with sleep deprivation, with sleep, we know that basically the brain flushes all the toxins out that accumulate during the day. It's sort of growth hormone, repair tissue. So if you stop that, what exactly happens over long term? One of the things I really find is the link between sleep deprivation and cancer. And I really think that I always advise my kids, make the room as dark as possible when you're sleeping to get the total melatonin secretion. They've actually found higher rates of breast cancer in women that work the night shift. So basically the melatonin mm-hmm. Throws off the estrogen, and then the estrogen is related to the cancer. There's many conflicting factors with breast cancer. I don't think we're there yet.
Right.
But we know that colorectal cancer, and there are different types of cancers that are associated with long-term sleep debt too. I mean, it's amazing what I've seen over the last 20 years of the science have shown how much sleep. There's a reason why we spend a third of our lives doing it, right?
Right.
Biologically, so it has a tremendous impact on the other two-thirds of the day. We don't spend 8 hours exercising. Other than me, we don't spend 8 hours a day eating. But, you know, there's got to be a reason why we sleep that much.
Yeah, I think they said if sleep is not critical, you know, the fact that we sleep 8 hours, it's the biggest evolutionary mistake ever. I mean, because, you know, this 8 hours, we could be doing things where, you know, potentially, at least in prehistoric times, at risk for the saber-toothed tiger. So it's got to be absolutely critical. And it's interesting, this whole issue about Alzheimer's disease, you know, the thing that gets built up in your brains with Alzheimer's called amyloid beta. And they actually have shown that when you get more sleep, that stuff gets flushed out of your brain. Kind of an interesting phenomenon.
Just recently, I was doing some research, and I found out that the state of Massachusetts would like to have the state legislature pass a bill recommending that schools start later in their entire state. They found that tardiness fell by 35% based on what they had seen in the state of New Hampshire, and D's and F's were also cut in half. And it goes without saying, the woman who spoke earlier, she said, I think her name was Allison, she said, the more stimulated the child is in the morning, exercise, for example, it stimulates the brain, it gets the brain going. My daughter will occasionally go running in the morning. When I was able to, would ride my bike and go with her so she wasn't out there running alone that early in the morning. Not everybody has that opportunity. But my point is, based upon Massachusetts, do you know of any other states that are willing or that have implemented a bill requesting that the entire state convert?
I believe Connecticut had tried to do that a couple of years ago, but I believe that Massachusetts is the most forward at this point. There's been attempts to try to do something on the national level,
right,
which I actually don't agree with, even though I work with the organization that does it to promote that, because I really think that it has to be kind of a local level. I would agree that it should be a goal. There should be maybe some financial incentives tied to it. That was actually what the Zoloft-Grün bill that was introduced years ago that I helped write was to try to give grants to people to allow them to do it. but I think mandating it would be wrong. But I think setting that goal and trying to get some incentives would be very important.
I do want to thank the school board members that are here this evening and Mr. James from Transportation also for bringing this to everyone's attention tonight. And I think one thing that we need to remember is the children of today is the future of tomorrow. If we do not give them the proper education they need today, America won't be all it could be in the future.
You're here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
I know that you talked several times about some different strategies that we as parents could give to our children. My daughter is in the School of the Arts program, so she has to be at the bus stop at 5:50. So that, you know, her bedtime is 9:30, but still, like you said, you know, having her try to fall asleep. What would you suggest as far as electronics stopped, like how far before bedtime? And are there any other strategies that we can implement?
You know, I may be delusional, I probably am, but an hour before, like a cool down time for an hour, would be wonderful. Now, whether that's really feasible with a high-functioning student who probably needs her electronics to do her schoolwork and whatnot. You know, I grew up at a time when, you know, we wrote in blue books at Duke University for our exams, but those days are all over. But at least, you know, an hour to my mind would be optimal, but, you know, 30 minutes, just some period of time before they go in the bedroom, and then most important, out of the bedroom, because there have been studies that show, I remember there was a study, I believe out of Japan, and the students admitted, I mean, there's this widespread use of their phones, you know, under the covers and whatnot. So I think if you just get them out of the bedroom, that would be a major step right there. But, you know, when your daughter has to be up so early, it's really, I mean, it's tough. It's tough to get them to biologically and with all the other things, schoolwork, to get them to go to bed at a reasonable time.
Is she driving?
No, she's in ninth grade.
Ninth grade, okay.
And that was, I'll tell you what, I had many tussles with especially my youngest daughter, about driving to school. She couldn't get enough, you know, she was fortunate that we were able to give her a car to drive to and from school more times than not. She didn't have to use the school bus system in Virginia Beach, which starts at 7:20. Nevertheless, oftentimes she didn't get enough sleep, and there were times where we had knockdown dragouts that she wasn't driving to school in the morning.
The other thing I would say is caffeine use. Caffeine is a very powerful drug, and we're seeing younger and younger kids using it, especially as Starbucks has come on the scene with sugary, you know, whipped cream drinks and so forth. And the monster drink, the energy drink, especially in the high schools, it's a $1 billion industry now. And there's over 500 different products out there. There's caffeinated gum, caffeinated mints, caffeinated soap even. That shows that you have a problem. So I would say try to, if they're using any drinks that have caffeine in it, limit those very early to keep that away from night. Also setting a good example and actually having talks about that, about especially once they get to the driving age, about kind of recognizing when they're really spent and burn the candle at both ends. I can't say that, stress that enough.
What Darrel says, you know, really good point about caffeine. The half-life of caffeine is 4 to 7 hours. So it's hanging around bathing our brains far longer than many of us would think. And I wish I had a nickel for every patient who told me it doesn't have any impact on their sleep, because I wouldn't be here. I'd be retired. I'd be rich. But it does lighten and fragment sleep. So to the extent that they don't have to have it at a time that, you know, after, say, the last 7-8 hours before bed, they're better off. Now, that having been said, if you have a, you know, you don't want your teen driving sleepy. But if your teen tells you honestly he or she is somewhere and they're tired, then they need to have a caffeinated beverage. And if and only if the environment is safe with this, they should follow that with a 20-minute nap. That combination of caffeine followed by a 20-minute nap can be rejuvenating.
Yeah. The other thing I would say is a hot shower or bath before bedtime, because it actually lowers the body temperature, raises the body temperature, and will help deepen the sleep. But the fact that she's an athlete, too, and exercise, that's also shown to improve, especially deeper sleep. But waking up that early, that's the same thing we told the swim kids in Fairfax. I got no solution for you. If you're if you're looking to jump in a pool, a cold pool at 5 o'clock in the morning, I got no solution for you.
And you'd mentioned something about with melatonin. Is that, like, if they're taking that earlier, is that sort of messing up the whole biological system?
Well, I am not a big proponent of melatonin. We're getting, I guess, a little.
Sorry.
It's a good question, but. I was just going to say that a lot of people use melatonin to help themselves sleep. I am not a big proponent of melatonin. I certainly would not be a big proponent of melatonin in our children. It's an overhyped sedating or sleeping pill type medication. Better to set things up, as Darrel said, with a cool, quiet, dark bedroom without the electronics, and allow their own melatonin, and in the vast majority of cases, their sleep and arousal systems work just fine. Okay, just let it all, let that take precedence.
Great, thank you so much.
Thanks. Well, thank you very much for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good job.
Dr. Vorona and Mr. Drobnich, we really thank you for coming and sharing information with us. And we appreciate your continued partnership with giving us more information we can share with our community about adolescent sleep patterns. Again, thank you for coming and being a part of us this evening. Thank you.
Our pleasure.
Thank you.